are watching grassroots community television, helping you make television people watch everywhere. Broadcasting on cable channel 82 in Glenwood Springs and Carbondale, and channel 12 in Aspen, Snowmass, Basalt, and Elgibel. Free over-the-air broadcasts throughout the Roaring Fork Valley. All programs can be watched anytime, anywhere at grassrootstv.org.
Welcome, everyone, to Naturalist Nights. My name is Howie Kuhn. I work here at ACES, and this weekly presentation is brought to you by Wilderness Workshop, the Roaring Fork Audubon Society, and Two Leaves and a Bud Teas. Next week, we have a presentation about how oil development is fracturing up our last wildland, so please come to that as well here and on Wednesdays in Carbondale as well. It is my honor tonight to introduce Pete McBride. Pete is a local and a photographer who's been published in countless publications, too many to name right here, and his work's really an inspiration for adventure, cultural exploration, and environmental awareness. So ladies and gentlemen, Pete McBride.
Thanks, Howie. I don't need that, Billy. Thanks for coming. Thanks for supporting ACES. I grew up learning about every duck and whatnot, and golden eagles right here, so it's a great place to bring your kids or adults alike. I've shown this talk a few times here, and I have a film which I'll show you a trailer for tonight, but I'm going to do something a little different, and just to give you, I am going to take you down the Colorado River, but I'm going to give you a little warm-up on some of the major rivers of the world before we get started. Just so you know, this was a I guess it's going into now the fourth year. It was 2 years of following the Colorado River. And there is a book that's out there if interested. But I'm going to start off with this somewhat abstract image of one of the most ancient pyramids in the world in Egypt. It's south of the pyramids of Giza. And the reason I'm starting here is I'm going to explain to you how I got interested in what I do today. It's been a while. It's 14 years ago. I had the fortune to see this pyramid from this perch. This was my first major assignment for National Geographic. This is a Vickers Vimy. It was built in 1918. This is a replica. And we took it the length of Africa. What takes now 11 hours on British Airways took us 58 days. And so to show you how I actually framed the shot for that, these are the pyramids of Giza. But what we were basically doing is flying London to Cape Town and roughly about 1,000 feet off the ground. And I became infatuated with not only that aerial perspective of showing ancient cultures, but also how water flows. This is the Zambezi River. Victoria Falls much further south. But what intrigued me the most on this trip, this was really an adventure story about the first aviators that opened up the African Air Passage in 1920. And we reenacted it. Actually, took us longer to do it than they did in 1920. Typical. But I became interested in the Nile. The Nile is the longest river in the world. It actually goes through 10 countries. And it starts in Tanzania and flows, drains much of Uganda, Rwanda, Sudan, Ethiopia, and it brings you to regions where people have their entire livelihood on boats selling you wares on the Nile. So we basically flew up the Nile and had to divert around Sudan when we did this project. But I got a small taste of this remarkable river that's so historic and so embedded in the kind of ancient archetype of our planet. Feluccas is what they're called, seeing them at sunset or seeing how people live. This boy actually lives on this boat. He never gets off it. And so this was, 10 years ago, I became very interested in the Nile. And of course, there's some debate. Is it the longest river in the world? Well, the Brazilians say no. There's been some debates that the Amazon is actually the longest river in the world. It goes back and forth. Right now we're sticking with, apparently, the Nile is the longest at 4,100 miles, 4,130. The Amazon is right about 4,000 miles, one of the largest rivers in the world that drains an immense amount of water. And I got brief introduction to the Amazon, where I was sent down there to go to this small floating village in Peru to actually get on a, find one of these dugout canoes, get out in the main body of the river, and which when you're out there is remarkable. It can be 2 miles across. And the reason I was sent there was a magazine story for Men's Journal and some other magazines was to follow this crazy character, Ed. He was a former, he was Special Forces out of England. He walked the entire length of the Amazon River. So I had the pleasure of finding him in the jungle and then following him. I grew up not too far from here. This could not be more of my worst nightmare. I mean, this is like dreading, this is like crawling under my bed when you're six at night. why? Well, there's things like the Kandera fish that that will swim up your urine stream, allegedly. There are reports of it. There's electric eels. I had a nice encounter with a 6-foot electric eel that I thought was a little like guppy fish with a flat head, and I was like, Ed, what's this fish? And then realized that the end was over by the window. They have enough, they have 600 volts, they'll drop you unconscious, and generally you drown, and that's how they get their prey. Fortunately, I didn't know what it was, so I didn't panic, and it didn't react. But that is just to give you an idea of how I was introduced to the Amazon. So this was 3 years ago. I've been working as a photographer, writer, and now a filmmaker, but it's been about 10 years. And so I've slowly been working around the world, doing a lot of work on rivers. Now, if the Amazon is, say, the lungs of the planet and one of the great rivers, it's one of the largest, most voluminous rivers, we will stay with the Nile being the longest. There is a river in northern India that is the most sacred, the Ganges. And I had the good fortune to, I was just there for National Geographic looking at it. This is in the foothills of the Ganges. Now the Ganges, interestingly, it's not the longest. It is also one of the most voluminous, but it's definitely the most polluted and most sacred rivers in the world. And where does it go? It actually drains the whole southern region of the Himalaya. So whenever we have people marching off to the Karakoram and the Himalaya to go play on ladders and test their challenges and their wits, this is on the south side of Everest. A lot of this drainage all comes in eventually through Nepal and into the Ganges. So this was another story I did, but I'm starting to realize how connective all these rivers really are. That's what people do when they're resting at base camp on Mount Everest, play baseball. So the Ganges flows down, it heads basically south. There's hundreds of tributaries in the Ganges, but it is definitely the most populated watershed in the world. It supports 400 million people, which is pretty remarkable. When you're up in the headwaters in the foothills, it's still quite spectacular. I was in a region where it's not that populated, and you have donkeys and whatnot and a lot of rafters. But what intrigues me about the Ganges, after spending a lot of time on rivers, is how sacred it is. It's very polluted. A lot of that is due to lack of awareness and poor human practices, a lot of industry. But it is the goddess of the Hindu religion. It is Ma Ganga, is where all life goes. And they believe that there's so many good vibrations. They use these analogies that if you go to a nightclub the next morning, you can say, this place has a bad vibe. Well, people, millions and millions of pilgrims, Westerners, whatnot, religious people, they'll spend years trying to get to the headwaters of the Ganges to get a little container of it because they believe that their best intentions come from that river, and people have been meditating and worshiping the river for thousands of years. So I went, of course, I took an unusual way to see the river, Royal Enfield. This is across one of the julas, one of the bridges. But wherever you go, you see how people are building monuments. They're going down and bathing, going down and praying, washing their feet, their hands in this river. And it's just unique. We, up here in Colorado, we look at our local rivers and we may cherish them to a degree, but we're not nearly as spiritual or indebted to the body of water like they are in India. This is also the capital of yoga. This is where we pick up a lot of our yoga and potentially distort it into tights and hot buns over here in the U.S. In India, it's all about your mind and opening up your body so you can meditate. But it's interesting. These are all the this is an orphanage that's there actually practicing yoga on a platform over the Ganges River. And this is Haridwar, which is right where the Ganges comes out and kind of spreads out from the foothills of the Himalaya into what's called the Gangetic Plain. And all these little lights that you see, these are people coming down at night. They come down every night. It's called Arti. And they sing and they cherish and they put little candles in little floating leaves. And they send it down the river to encapsulate their prayers. So these lights flowing down the river, this guy had a big one. These are all candles that they're putting in. They do it every evening. Of course, that leads to part of the contamination. So I've been doing this for a long time. I've been looking at rivers. And I've been doing some foolish things, dealing with water, jumping in some very cold bodies of water. And I decided I wanted to jump into more my local area. I wanted to focus on something close to home. So we live in the Colorado watershed. We're sitting right in the headwaters here. And so right around 2008, I started thinking of what would happen if I followed the river. And by happenstance, a guy named John Waterman, who lives in Carbondale, he decided to get involved too, and he decided to paddle the entire length of the river, and we worked as a team. I didn't paddle the entire length, but I paddled a good chunk of it. But I started getting curious about how this river works. Where does it go? Here's the official start, if we're going to do a pinpoint on the map. That's Rocky Mountain National Park in Poudre Pass. Drops 12,000 feet, and we may know it through here. This is where we are, Glenwood. And then you come down, you see the Grand Canyon, Hoover Dam in Vegas, and then, like many, I didn't really know what happens here. And then where does the river really end? A lot of people say, San Diego, and it ends down here, Sea of Cortez. And I'm going to walk you now down the river and explain where the water goes. So here we are. This is actually Snowmass Peak. This is our backyard. This is part of the headwaters. Interesting phenomenon is this dust on snow we've been getting. If you live here, you see it in the springtime. It's increased development and to the west of us, mostly oil and gas, but also grazing. Kicks up dust, and we get these snowstorms with a lot of dust in it, which it actually is speeding up the evaporation process of the river. It's we're losing about 5% of the runoff because it comes off at a much faster rate. Now, this would be the pinnacle, one of the highest points of the Continental Divide. Colorado has this interesting phenomenon where we've got this ridge running right through the state, and the Colorado River is basically the western side. All the snow and rain gets collected on the western side, so we call it the 80-20 rule. We have 80% of the water on the west, but 80% of the population lives on the eastern side in Denver. So this is right about the pinnacle of this western side. This is, if you've ever been to Leadville and driven, you've probably driven this road to Denver. The Climax Mine, these are the tailings piles. So this is right at the headwaters. You can imagine what happened if this breached, a lot of heavy metals. But that's the Blue River going up to Dillon Reservoir. The Eagle River comes out here towards Vail, and then Arkansas, which is not part of the Colorado River Basin, ends up in Mississippi, comes out the bottom. So if we're going to follow the Blue River, I'm going to take you up north, kind of towards Rocky Mountain National Park. This is where the town of Dillon before 1961. And Denver has a huge appetite for water, so we started building reservoir storage capacity. So we built a dam there, and this is what became a Dillon. There are now 22 diversion projects that take water from this side of the state underneath the Continental Divide. Some of it catches it up high and brings it over to Denver and the greater Denver metro area, Pueblo, Boulder. And one of the first ones is called the Grand Ditch, built in the late 1800s, dug by hand. You see that whole stripe dug by hand, and it takes water. It catches water before it runs into the river. So we're in Rocky Mountain National Park here, and I'm looking north. That's the river. And so that's just one of the first diversions, and that brought water to agriculture on the other side. So I went and met John. That's John starting out on his paddling. We took these little Ferrari-like boats. One of the few spots you can see moose. Of course, the moose have been migrating down to this area. We've been seeing a few. Tremendous amount of beetle kill in Rocky Mountain National Park. lights are a little bright, but most of these trees are in here orange and already died off. About 80% of Rocky Mountain National Park is died off. Of course, some beautiful fall foliage. There's another issue with aspen trees called SAD, the sudden aspen tree demise. We're seeing a lot of that in that area. So the river, as it starts building momentum and collecting all this snow melt, a good portion of it gets diverted right away at Lake Granby, right underneath the Continental Divide to Denver. And so you come here by Kremling. Just to back up for a second to give you an idea how much water goes to Denver, this river right here is the Roaring Fork. 50% of that river gets taken before it even reaches Aspen to Denver. Same with the Frying Pan River. So we're changing the nature of what we've done to this river dramatically. So I've taken you basically from Aspen, I've done a big loop up Leadville up to Rocky Mountain National Park. Rocky Mountain National Park is up there. And I took you briefly up the Blue River, which here it comes and it joins the Colorado right here. So this is right at Kremling, if you've ever been to Kremling, a little agricultural community. And it drops right away into actually the steepest drop of the whole river. Most precipitous drop is Gore Canyon. Great fun for whitewater boaters, class 5 water. It's one of the top probably 3 or 4 runs in the country. Fun if you're going forward, facing backwards, trying to photograph was kind of a nightmare. I kept cranking the camera into my head. Cold too, but so that's John on the right. And as it comes out of Gore Canyon, it comes down and meets the Eagle River that picks up from Vail, and then there's Glenwood Canyon, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. Mount Sopris in the upper left. So you can start to see kind of how this river is draining this immense amount of area. Glenwood Canyon, you can also see how this river is not only we shape it, but it shaped us. It's carved these passages for us. Look what we've used this river for transportation. We have a 4-lane highway. This 19-mile section of highway here costs more to build than the rest of I-70, which goes from Nevada to Washington, D.C. We have the Rio Grande Railroad right there, train coming through, Shoshone Dam, also part of Denver's complex water network. And then, of course, it's picking up all these other tributaries. So this is where I live, basalt, gold medal water for fishing, if there are any fisher folk in the crowd. And very famous for what kind of fish. You know, everyone thinks the native fish are the rainbow and the brown. That's a big brown lunker that my friend Nate's hooking up with. Another challenging photograph to make. He's out there having fun fishing. I'm lying in my belly in the gravel, you know, gasping water, trying to see what the heck's going on. And of course, there's the rainbow. Now, what's interesting is these are not native species. These were introduced into the river system, and they've actually played a huge role in decimating the native species, which I'll get to later. Of course, Glenwood Canyon and the rapids around us are famous for boaters, whatnot, kayakers. This is, and then my favorite pastime is now surfing the river. This is the Glenwood Wave. I do this quite a bit down. There's a wave we were able to surf near Grand Junction called Big Sur. I think I encapsulated my entire surf career in one ride on the river, because you can ride for, you know, 45 minutes. When I go out in the ocean, I'm just getting pummeled for a few seconds. Now, this project, it originated, to a degree, happened because John was paddling the river and we started working and collaborating, but it also happened because I grew up in Old Snowmass. We moved out there when I was about 8, and my family still lives there. I live in Basalt, but we have a cattle ranch. We run about 100 head of cattle. We put up 300 tons of hay, and we used to do all our irrigation with gravity fed. So you divert these ditches, and I spent my summers, that's all I did basically, is irrigate. And when you're irrigating gravity fed, you put a dam, and you have a lot of time. You sit there and go, I wonder if the water's going to make it here, I wonder where it's going to go. So I started thinking a lot. I wonder what exactly happens to this water. Where does it go? Because generally, when you flood irrigate, you need more water to get across the field, so you're sending more that's going to go back into the system. So I started wondering, how long would this water here coming out of either our ditch or a sprinkler take to reach the ocean? Pretty simple question, which I never believed that some 20 years later I'd actually chase, so to speak. That's the aerial perspective on one of these sprinklers. These are interesting because we went to these sprinklers. They're gravity-fed, no motors at all. They run entirely 24 hours a day. You just move them, and they're running because we just off the pressure that we create by shrinking pipes as you move downhill. So this goes to hay. We put up 300 tons, I said, grass, hay mostly, not much alfalfa. It's too cold here. But most of it goes to feed out agriculture. 70% of the river, in some areas it's 78 actually, goes to provide support agriculture in the Southwest. And just to clarify, people get a little confused here. Those are shadows, so I'm screaming along, and we're looking straight down on these horses. Different but similar perspective. Cattle's the big one. So it's the same concept. The cows that look blue, those are actually their shadows. So it's this aerial image that I was actively pursuing because I believe that this river, the Colorado, is not the longest in the U.S. It's not the largest. It's the seventh, but it's definitely the most loved and also the most litigated. And as a result, there's thousands of pictures of it. So I wanted to employ something a little different, and I think this aerial perspective gives us a little sense of where we've been and where we haven't. And I was fortunate to have this wingman, my old man, my father John, who is a pilot. This is a Cessna 180 that he flies. And so I got to act like I was bossing him around a little bit. Of course, he was telling me you ought to take a picture of that and that. No, it was a great partnership. So he flew the upper basin with me. Local pilot Bruce Gordon was very helpful, too, with EcoFlight for the locals here. Now, as the river flows out of Colorado, comes into Utah, it's picking up more tributaries. That's Monument Valley, just north of Moab. That's Moab off to the right, the river on the lower left here. And if you've been to Moab, you've probably at least heard of or been to Arches National Monument, National Park. That's Delicate Arch. I mean, right there. So these are all the people that have, probably most of them from Europe, it seems, whenever I go there. They're looking through Delicate Arch with the framing the LaSalles, but we've seen that picture, so that's why I'm trying to show something different. And you can see how the river's sculpted a lot of this region. If you do a 180-degree about-face, most people don't realize just south of Moab is this potash mine. Very interesting. They mine potash from about 2,000 feet below the surface, and they slurry it up with Colorado River water, which they dye blue. Why? Because it speeds up the evaporation. Now, this potash mine isn't that. They're doing a decent job, but what I'm trying to highlight here is we're using this river a lot in a lot of different areas, not just front lawns, not just drinking water, not just hay, but industry. And the demands are only coming up, especially with oil and gas and fracking. It's going to increase because it. If you've been following the fracking debate, and it's pretty water consumptive. Now, meanwhile, if we head up north, because the basin is really seven states, you have the Little Snake on the left and the Yampa River on the right, and they're coming out of Wyoming. They merge here, and you can see the different sediments. You can also see how the change in what would have been the natural landscape on the left versus how we've changed it towards agriculture on the right. Comes down to meet the green, which can be very green. And then the Yampa and the green meet here at Echo Park, Dinosaur National Monument. What's interesting here is this was once a proposed dam site, right there. It was heavily fought in the 60s and won, but it came at a cost, which I'll get to later. Now, the Green is actually the longest tributary. It's longer than the Colorado River. Why is it not called the Colorado? Because the Colorado River actually carries more water. Now, it comes down, and the confluence is just below this image, which is one of my favorite images. The Green's coming in right about there. But this is called the Loop, natural double oxbow. In a few more million years, it will probably erode through one of those oxbows and become a dead oxbow. And this is the beginning of, we're in Canyonlands right now, and it's also Cataract Canyon, which is one of the most largest navigable rapid on the entire river. I went down last summer at one of our record high water runs. We had this huge snowpack, this record-breaking snowpack, which I'll get to. It kind of restored some of the deficit we've been seeing with water loss. But this is, I went on the cushy safe route. I went on one of these giant motorboats because I was nervous. Mainly because I went three summers ago and we had a big runoff. The last photo was going down at about 75,000 cubic feet per second. The river usually runs at around, on average, around 10 to 12. Grand Canyon usually runs around 10 to 15, to give you an idea. This was a couple years ago. I went down with some friends, and this is only at 60,000, but this is what led to me being nervous and getting on the big boat. My friend Fletcher Yaw is somewhere there. Matt Holstein is over there, and I can't remember who else is there. So that's the last frame going into what's called Satan's Gut. Not where you want to be. We completely screwed up. So that's the next frame. Fun to say, not necessarily. It's fun to have swum Cataract Canyon, not fun to actually swim Cataract Canyon. It's a little nerve-wracking. Now, Cataract Canyon, what's interesting is it comes down in the last point where the river is kind of running in its full might and glory and natural existence, as natural as it can be today, and it runs into Lake Powell. And what's interesting with Lake Powell is it collects all that sediment. The saying is that the river used to be too thick to plow and too thin to drink. The other way around, too thick to drink and too thin to plow. And that's because the river was carrying down all this erosion and sediment. And you can see some of it building up right in here. There's massive amounts of silt that's happening. This is looking southwest across Lake Powell. Now, this was the canyon that nobody knew, is what they called it. And this, what happened at Echo Park, and the fight that stopped the dam there, the agreement with the Bureau of Reclamation was that if they stop and agree to not put the dam there, that they can't put up any opposition to fight this area. So this was this was the canyon that nobody knew, and this is what became of it. And these photos here, this repeat photo was done by John when he was paddling the river. He'd go out and spend hours trying to track these things down. Not easy to do. But just showing how we've transformed this area. That's looking basically east-north. La Salle Mountains right there. So you can see how this river was sculpting this huge, massive area through the desert and how we've filled it up. Now, we've been in a 10-year drought heading into basically our second decade of drought. All the reservoirs are dropping significantly. We did get a little bump last year, but it's pretty minimal. So you can see that's a 6-foot-high water skier. That's about 75 feet high of water deficit. So that's called the bathtub ring. And here's, of course, the dam. Glen Canyon Dam. And that below it starts the Grand Canyon. This is one of my favorite images from the project. The smoke in the background is from wildfire, something we'll probably see more and more of, especially with beetle kill. Not an easy photo to get. It seems like it'd be easy, but it's very complicated airspace up there. There was open to air traffic, and they've restricted it immensely because there was a lot of people sightseeing in the 60s, 70s. There's actually a mid-air collision debris that scattered all around this area that they never collected. Two commercial flights were out, sightseeing on their way wherever and ran into each other. So you have to fly strict patterns. And even I was with a very good pilot, and we had an engine failure right about 10 minutes before that. And you're just like, really? And fortunately, the engine sputtered back to life, and here I am. Now, if you go in the canyon, another proposed dam site during the glory of the Bureau of Reclamation. Marble Canyon, that's where if you float the river, you can see these holes that they bored to see if they could actually build the dam. Beautiful spot. And just upstream from there and south, actually, is one of the most beautiful tributaries, I think, called the Little Colorado. It's calcium-rich waters. That's what gives it that milky look. And this is where you get this little fellow. This is the humpback chub. This is one of the native species. They grow this big hump here. That's a subadult. Not an easy photo to get. I spent the entire day sitting around the river with these scientists who were trying to tag fish. And they don't know exactly what that hump was for that they grow, either to navigate the huge runoffs, the big floods, or to echolocate prey. But they do know that they're struggling. There's only about 6,000 of them. Why? Mainly because of invasive predators we brought in, but also because of cold water. They don't like cold water. They grew up with this desert hot river water. And the water that comes out of below the dam, in Glen Canyon Dam, is 39 degrees pretty much year-round. So they're struggling to adapt with that. So we're trying to give them a helping hand. These are some of the biologists that come down and tag them. This is such a young one that they don't actually, they put computer chips in their bellies right here. This one's too young, so you see a little bit of that green dye. They'll dye them here, and it'll usually last for a year, and so that's how they're doing population studies. Now there's four endangered species. Two have already gone extinct. These are the remaining, there's four left. The pike minnow up top, and bony-tailed chub, and then the razorback sucker on the bottom. And you can look and, you know, there's pockets where they exist, and they're hard to find, even if you got a good cell phone, they're hard to find. But so I just took the easy way out. I went to the Cabela's flagship hunting store in Phoenix, Arizona, and I went scuba diving in their aquarium. So the kid is not, I don't think he really cares about what these kind of prehistoric fish are doing. He's like, who's this character in there? Now, if you're in the Grand Canyon, this is Nankoweap Point, very famous spot. You've probably seen a lot. I was trying to get something different. It's a nice camp spot there. Beautiful to get in and stretch out your legs and relax. Thousands of visitors here. Recently, they just, it was a month ago that Salazar just actually amended the law that we will not do any more uranium mining in the Grand Canyon, which was, I think, a big success. Arizona is saying, well, that's a huge loss for jobs, but I try to remind people you can't really export the Grand Canyon. There's nowhere else to go. There's only one in the world, and 100 million visitors a year come to it. Local boy Dave Kaczynski is a Grand Canyon guide down there. He kindly took me down. This is Lava Falls, one of the most famous rapids towards the end. Another aerial shot that I like. Now, President Roosevelt, in 1903, he came here, and he came to the South Rim, and he came by train, and he was instrumental in creating Grand Canyon National Park. Apparently, it was unscripted. I haven't been able to figure this out, but his 20-minute stop, he looked over the ridge, looked down the trail, and he said this quote, which is one of my favorites. He says, "Leave it as it is. You cannot improve on it. The ages have been at work on it, and man can only mar it." So I think what we did, what Salazar recently did is, you know, testimony that we're trying to maintain that spot. When you exit Grand Canyon, you come down to Lake Mead and Hoover Dam. Once was the largest dam in the world, built in 1935. There's enough concrete in this baby to build a four-lane highway from Boston to Seattle. Pretty remarkable. I think if my memory serves me correctly, was the total cost was like $8 billion to build this. 1935, a lot of money then, but still it's remarkable what they did. Another view of it, you can see the bathtub ring. Now, because of drought, climate change is playing a huge role. All the projections are that the river's getting going to get hotter and drier and lower, and levels are dropping, and of course we have more straws in the drink. Vegas is so concerned, they're building what's called the third straw. What's happened here is that the water levels are getting so low that one of their intake valves is right over here. It's out of the frame, but it's getting, the water level is too low for their intake valve. So they're building this straw that's going to take 5 years, maybe six. They had a screw up recently. The tunnel was going the wrong direction, but $800 million, they're going to bore a tunnel that's going to come up underneath and basically be the drain under Lake Mead so they can have water. Of course, there are projections. If we stay on the path we are, with drought and potentially climate change and maybe over allocation issues, that Lake, some people predict that by 2020, 2025, Lake Mead will be dry. Las Vegas, interesting place. So when I started the project, I was like, well, you know, well, that's the problem. Vegas, you know. Well, what's interesting is when they wrote the Colorado Compact, which is the law of the river, it was written in 1922, and seven states, to my amazement today, they got together and they actually agreed on this law. And it's actually a pretty well-written, pretty good law. Nobody had any idea that Vegas would be there. They were like, the middle of Nevada in the desert? Who's going to live there? So they gave them a very small amount of water. So Vegas, ironically, they're the big decadent oasis dream here with pools everywhere and water fountains galore. They get so little water that they've been forced to be very progressive and very environmental. Patricia Mulroy, who runs their water authority, has become by default an environmentalist. So they have I mean, this may be a band-aid in the scheme of things, but it's helpful when the river's dying from a million cuts. I mean, you got to do what you can do, but they have, in most areas, mandatory pool coverages. All the fountains are gray water, which is your shower and faucet water. And then during their boom, they were paying people $2 in credit, a square foot, to come in and tear up your front lawn. So I took a picture of this house, an average, you know, middle-income home, at 8 in the morning, same day, 11. Guy was pretty happy. He got a paycheck, a credit check from the water authority, felt like he was doing his part for the river. And once the xeriscaping grows in, it, you know, it's actually quite attractive. Nobody's too hot to stand on your front lawn out there anyway. Side note, interesting side note, is xeriscaping originated actually in Denver. And they're doing it to a degree, but Vegas is kind of the champion of it. So hopefully as little measures like that will, you know, save water for us for, you know, basking around in the pools like we like. But also, I'd hope that it saves a little bit for the critters, too. That's a Rocky Mountain toad, and that's one of the perks of spending all day in the Little Colorado looking for humpback chub. Is this little lady had a little love affair with my lens. I don't know what. She kept wanting to swim onto the lens. So we're going to move south now. The river has just done a big jog below Hoover Dam. It turns and becomes the border with Arizona and California. And Lake Havasu you see here, this is the Colorado River Aqueduct. It goes 242 miles right here, big straw. That goes to, and you can see it picking up over there. That's going due west to Los Angeles. If you do about a 170-degree turn, look the other side and look southwest. This is the CAP, the Central Arizona Project. This just dumbfounds me how they built this. 336 miles long uphill to Phoenix and Tucson. And these little guys here, these are actually called recharge ponds. Arizona is generally gets beaten up as the big water buffalo. They like, there's no problem, whatever. Climate change, big deal. We got plenty of water. We'll make it work. So they're called the water buffaloes to a degree. But they're aware that there's a huge issue pending. If we didn't have the huge snowpack last year, the state of Nevada and Arizona were going to have water restrictions. These recharge ponds is Arizona actually storing water. They're letting that water seep back into the water table. So they're banking water back into their water table because they realize we're having some issues. Tucson has done some very interesting things. They've done some pay schedules that you can donate water back to conservation if you save water out of your faucet by being more efficient. Phoenix, on the other hand, has 150 golf courses. Not really cutting edge. There are areas. Scottsdale's doing some programs, but in general, it's they bring in a lot of water and they use it a bit recklessly, in my opinion. That's right downtown Scottsdale. And the Gila River is one of the last tributaries of the Colorado, and this is one of the pictures that John Waterman went out and did recently, and this is what's become of it. So that's the Gila. We're down quite a bit south of Phoenix now, and the Gila is doing a big right-hand jog. It's starting to head due west to meet the Colorado, but there's actually no water in the river here. There's a little bit seeping up for irrigation, but whenever it picks up in the river, it's quickly diverted and sent off, basically, so we can green the desert. These are pistachios, pretty water-intensive crop. You can see how we've taken this ethic of greening the desert, which there's been people over the course of history from John Wesley Powell who said, you just can't do this. This river is semi-arid, and that's what it's meant to be, and it's always going to be that way. And then we've had other people that said, no way, the rivers, we can do whatever we want. The rain will follow the plow, was the saying. So there's been a debate over this for years. Where do I sit on it? I think that we can do a mix of both. Having grown up on a ranch, we still have cows. I mean, I don't even eat that much meat anymore, but I think there are ways to raise beef effectively. This is in the Imperial Valley. Is this the most effective, efficient place to be doing this? It's 127 degrees when I took this picture. Massive amount of water to sustain this. Maybe not the best place to have cattle. Of course, the Imperial Valley gets about 3/4 of the water that California takes from the Colorado River. California is the biggest user of the Colorado River. Most of it goes towards ag in that area. A lot of it goes towards lettuce, though. And lettuce may be a very good crop because it's about the only place in the country that we can raise lettuce effectively and efficiently throughout the winter. In fact, in the months of December and January, it's the only place in the country you can get lettuce unless you have your own greenhouse. So if you live in New York or Boston, January, you're eating the Colorado River. So whether you live and love the river or you don't know anything about it, it's kind of in our, I think, in our best interest as a country to care for it. And just a side story, having hung around this area for quite a bit, going up with crop dusters, this pilot later took me up, crazy pilot. He flies at night, he does everything. That's high for him. Usually his wheels are spinning on the crops, but he's just high because he wants to avoid those sprinklers. I got doused, the wind changed, and whenever he sprang, doused me. And he said, you know, it's probably a pretty good idea you have about four showers. So some of it's organic down there, but most of it's not. And these are the pickers I went out with, a great bunch group, singing, happy, actually pretty well-paid job. But you can see there, they talk about their hands going black, getting weird blisters on their mouth from being around this. This lettuce gets picked, bagged, boxed, right to the grocery store. So just something, just the word for the wise, wash your lettuce. Yeah, I had no idea. So now the river, historically, and why we're in this dilemma today, is that it used to just rage at times. In the spring, June, it would come roaring down and have these huge floods. In the early 1900s, it ran at record levels. This is Yuma, Arizona, and this was a flood that came down with 200,000 CFS, cubic feet per second, immense. So I understand why we have controlled and dammed this river to a degree. It'd be you know, romantic to think the Colorado would be a wild river, but today's world, that's, I think, unrealistic. But in the process, we've controlled it so much that we've turned it into this piddly little creek that at Yuma, you can walk across this and it barely gets your ankles wet. And it's like that year-round. And so these floods that happened in the early 1900s, they were somewhat of an anomaly. And so when they came and sat at the table down in New Mexico, when all seven states put their heads together and drafted the Colorado Compact, they had that as their main source of data. They're like, well, this river really, it's got a lot of water. So that's what they divvied up. That's what they created the pie, or call it the extra large soda cup, if you want. And they put each state's straw in that soda. And now we realize that, oops, actually with tree ring studies and inflow stream rights studies, that the river flows at about 3/4 of what they thought it did. So we really have a medium soda, but everyone has their straw in the extra large, to put it in layman's terms. And nobody wants to take their straw out. So that's part of the reason why we're getting into this dilemma where we are, which I'll show you. This is the last dam on the river, the Morelos Dam. You see the Welton Mohawk Mode Canal heading off there to the up on the left. That's actually wastewater that is somewhat of an accident. It's too salty. It's been reused so many times. It's too salty to put on crops. That accidentally was used to sustain a little part of the delta, which now we keep year-round because we realize it's such an important bird sanctuary. But this photo is hard, very hard to get for a number of reasons. This is the U.S.-Mexican border. It actually runs for 23 miles. It's called the Limitrof. It was famous for bird hunting, but I'm looking due south, and the U.S.-Mexican border fence is running due south right next to it. So the border does this little south jog, and Mexico gets its allotted amount of water that we promised them. In 1944, we agreed to give them 1.5 million acre feet, and we give it to them. A million acre feet's a football field, a foot deep. The river, as you see, kind of whimpers out. But what's hard is this is the border, and the border's become very tense with all the drug trafficking. So I went up with the Border Patrol, was very cautious about what I said. This pilot deported his own brother because he overstayed a student visa by two days. So once I learned that, I didn't ask too many requests. But he was great. The fact he took me up, he enabled me to get those photos. He enabled me to photograph some of the end of the river. That's the border fence. That's us playing cat and mouse. Border Patrol dragging tires so they can see if there's been tracks, and then they radio down. We got a runner. The river is right about here. And so we're just a little bit east. Now, the price that I had to pay is in order to go up with them, I had to go out with the whole sortie. So I went out in the helicopter 30 feet off the ground for 6 hours. A little nerve-wracking. He's got a MAC-10 on his lap, and we're strafing. I'm getting a little sick after a while. But it was fascinating to see what happens. This is one of the tributaries that's dry at this time of year, part of the Colorado. But these are that's another chopper that he flies with. They have A and B choppers, 20, 30 feet off the ground. They're so good they can see the foot tracks of immigrants. And these are two drug runners that they caught. We caught 7, I guess, that day, all carrying packs of 95 pounds of marijuana mostly. I mean, it's just that's a whole other issue, but it's remarkable to see these people. They walk across the Sonoran Desert, try to do it in 2 days. And most of them are just mules. They're just people at the end of their ropes. It's the drug runners that are hiring them. They're super sophisticated. They've got all the night vision goggles. They actually make booties. They're so sophisticated that they put booties over the drug runners, the poor lads. They pay them $5 to run across the desert. The booties look like animal tracks. So, complicated game of cat and mouse going on down there. But if you leave the border, if you get through it, like John and I did, we crossed the border by foot, no problems. Took a cab out to the river, and the cab driver was like, "Oh, great adventure, gran aventura." He was all excited, and we got excited. There was water that day in the river, and we're like, "Wow, man, we're going to paddle through the delta. This is cool." We paddled 2 miles till we ran into this. And this is to give you an idea of what it looks like in real time.
What is this stuff?
I don't know.
Can you paddle backwards and then forwards again?
All I know is I'm not that excited to get into this water.
So this is what's become of the mighty Colorado.
Yeah.
I tried to keep 1 foot in the water only.
Colorado is now a recycling center and tamarisk collection zone.
So that was the end of our paddle, just 2 miles in. That's about 90 some miles shy of the Sea of Cortez. It's actually retreated further. It's about 100 miles now. So this was the western flank of the delta, which I'll come back to a map and show you. This picture was taken by a guy named Edward Alfonso Goldman, 1906. John and I did this one together. We spent a day. We just knew there was a cinder cone somewhere in this old washed out photo, but we found it, and that's what's become a... So the delta used to be 3,000 square miles. It was the largest desert estuary in North America. And was the breeding ground for the Totowaba, which is the large sea bass. It would get up 12 feet long. And it's also home to the Cocopa. This is a Cocopa Indian. There was about 20,000 of them that lived in the area. And this guy who took us out here, he actually learned to fish right here. So very drastic change. They're definitely the most kind of unheard minority voice on the river. There's only about 1,500 of them left. This is their ancestral rights. They're the only ones that have rights to fish here, but obviously there's no water. Just to the west is what's interesting here. It's this isn't a jab at four-wheelers. It just shows how we're still adapting and using these sands used for now, a fun place to go rip around on are all the historic sands that have come down from the Grand Canyon. And since we've actually dried up the delta, these sands have been blowing and creating one of the largest inland desert sand deserts down in Mexico now. And that's just been a recent phenomenon that's happened in the last 10 years. So John and I packed up the boats and we walked. The whole time I think I was wondering why the hell am I carrying a boat? I started out with 7 gallons of water, cameras, food, whatnot. I could barely walk, and so we realized we weren't making it fast enough. We were running out of water, so we actually asked some farmers, found some of these. There was a couple irrigation canals that we paddled to help us speed our way, and which definitely helped. Not a very romantic way to paddle the Colorado River. And then those ran out, and we walked some more. It took us 2 trips, actually. John's foot got extremely infected. He said in that little video clip that I only put one foot in the water. Well, that one foot went completely septic. He had a blister, and it, 3 days later, it was just a little pus factory. So we had to bail and come back. And on our second mission, we finally made the entire 90-some miles. Some of it we paddled in canals. Most of it we walked. And we made it to this town, El Golfo de Santa Clara. And it's one of the old fishing villages, which is on the eastern flank of the Sierra Cortez. And these are all the guys that depend on the shrimp. And the shrimp are dependent on that brackish kind of mixing of freshwater and saltwater. And so the shrimp fisheries have dropped way off. This is John on our first sortie out. This is how we get back. This was walking out to the road on the west side of the delta where we hitchhiked for 6 hours. The last 3 hours we held out money. And it didn't work. And then finally, random, there's just those good Samaritans in the world. This guy came up. He didn't want money. He wanted to buy us beers. He wanted to do everything. And he drove us all the way to a hotel on the border. So we're getting close to the end here. I'm going to just give you an idea where we've been. Obviously, that's the Grand Canyon. Most of you may know. There's the Hoover Dam again. I came over here into the Phoenix area. This is the CAP, that Central Arizona diversion. This is the Colorado one. Here's the Gila. I can't see that one too well, but the Gila's coming down here. And the Frappuccino pit where I was paddling is right about there. So the Delta used to stretch this whole area. And I think what I find interesting about this project is there's a lot of discussion about climate change and this and that, and is it nature's taking its course? I think this is a real testament of what's happened because of our impact. And I think it's testimony to what happens when we ask too much of a limited resource. Yes, we made some mistakes on how much water's in the river, and we can, I think, fix it. We can find greater efficiencies. But basically, when you ask too much, it disappears. So this is an aerial shot of one of the cocopas that are still somewhat optimistic that they may fish, and they leave their boats out there. But I like this image because it has kind of that artery feel. And I think of our rivers as our arteries of the planet. This is one of our last camps in the Delta that I like to talk about because it was one of my favorite spots in the river. And ironically, it was probably the wildest spot I experienced on the entire river. Wilder than the Grand Canyon. I saw more species, particularly of birds here, than I did anywhere else. And I'm actually quite hopeful because I think a lot of this has happened out of a lack of awareness. The Delta is in a part of the world that nobody really knows about. And we're starting to know about it a little bit. Small projects like this have helped to a degree, but things like people that do care about rivers are starting to make a difference. This was a billboard that ran in Grand Junction. And this is opposing a new diversion that's been proposed called the Million Project that would divert water from the Green River all the way 460 miles to Pueblo, Colorado. There's a lot of proposed diversion projects. We're not everyone's thinking, well, this is what we have. We have X in the river. We're going to have to live with it. Some think that, but a lot think we just need to get it somewhere else. But I'm also hopeful because I'm a big fan of dark places. And if you look at a map of the U.S. at night, there are a couple dark spots that still remain. This would be Los Angeles and San Diego. That would be Yuma, Mexicali, and that is the Delta. It's a dark spot that is still very wild as a result. You can actually see how the river sculpted so much. This is Vegas coming up. There's Denver. You can see how it kind of follows this line through here of growth and development. But it's still untouched here, and I think a little bit of water, we can bring it back to its former wild self. So Aldo Leopold, he took a canoe down the Delta in 1922. And he wrote a quote I like quite a bit. He said, "On the map, the Delta was bisected by the river, but in fact the river was nowhere and everywhere. For he could not decide which of 100 green lagoons offered the most pleasant and least speedy path to the Gulf." And then that canal I showed you when I was, the image of the last dam came up from Mexico, the one that has water that's too salty to use for irrigation, it goes down and sustains this. This is called the Cienega de Santa Clara. And that's the last of the estuary, the last of the delta that has water. It's about 10% of its former self. And I think some people think that it won't take much water. There are a lot of groups working on it, and I'll tell you what you could actually do, which there's something happening right now with the legislation around the river that could use all our voices. But I'll show you this. It's a video made, a movie.
I was curious about a river that ran through my backyard. I just wanted to know where our irrigation water went and how long it would take that water to reach the sea.
Well, are we ready to swim?
I'm scared.
We were just father and son, two buddies flying the river.
We're trying to find a way to the coast.
I'm not that excited to get into this water. We've run out of water after about 2 miles, and we're trying to navigate our way down what was once the Colorado River, which looks far from a river and more like a desert.
A short film I did out of this project. It came a little bit as an afterthought. The book was the origination, kind of the concept that John and I were doing together. And I'll leave you with this image, and then I'll tell you some exciting things that are happening. There's part of the reason why I wanted to talk about world rivers is this really is a world river. And this was a photo exhibit that happens in France. And this was 5,000 people came out to see this, and there's tremendous amount of care and interest in this river. So it's it may not be the most sacred, it may not be the longest, it may not be the biggest, but it is definitely one of the most loved. And it may be the most litigated, but I think if we care about it enough, I think we can bring it back to being a living river. And so what is happening today, and something that I think it's easy for us to participate in, is there's the U.S. and Mexican governments are actually having negotiations, and they're talking about recreating an agreement that they're going to release the news on, I've heard, sometime in March. And if you go to savethecolorado.org, it's a group of people that is very active in trying to spread the word. Patagonia is involved, New Belgium Brewery, a bunch of others. They have a petition you can sign just to, that'll be sent to the commission that's working on this. And what the gist of it, it's a very tight-lipped group, but is that the Mexicans will commit 50,000 acre-feet, and they're hoping the U.S. will too, and that's not, in the scheme of the water world, that's nothing. And that would hopefully, depends on the big question mark is what's happened with our groundwater and how much we've sucked up the ground table, because that's all connected. But I think it's very hopeful, and they haven't had discussions like this in a long time. And so some people are very positive. But you can go, this site prompts you where to go. I encourage people to jump on board. It's just a signature. They're not gonna take your bank info or anything like that. But I'll end with that. Thank you very much, and enjoy our rivers.